Thank you, ladies. Good morning. Good morning. Thank you, Pam. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Our announcements, I think, in the bulletin are pretty complete. The Fall Festival is coming up. A chili cook-off is coming up. And the women's Bible study on Wednesday nights, Ellen says that anybody can jump in at any time, even if you've missed the first session. And remember, on November 10th, we're going to have a combined service at 10 a.m. Does anybody else have any announcements? Okay, then let's stand and read the call to worship. Let your heart shine.
Let your heart be glad.
God is faithful to us, and God rules in love.
Let us worship.
Let us join in the first hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. The Apostles' Creed. Christians, in what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Would anyone like to be? Am I running the prayer thing around? Okay, it's me. Okay, tell me what you want to pray for, and I'll be right around with the mic.
You got to raise your hand for me.
Yes, yes, yes. Nobody has any prayer requests. Okay.
For my grandchildren. Just for
my Your grandchildren? Okay. I get that. I pray for my grandchildren every day.
Yeah, I'd like to thank everyone that sent cards to me while I was laid up and Pastor Vincent's visit. I'm feeling much better now.
Good, good, good. Yeah.
My sister's daughter's son had trouble with his back and had to go to the hospital because his dad had to carry him down the stairs. And it was now it's left me. Anyway, some kind of arthritis, septus arthritis, which usually happens under age 6. But anyway, they had to do blood work, and he thought it was in his hip going down his leg, but here they found the infection was by his spine. And so they had to put him on a strong antibiotic, and the blood work has turned around and good, and if it's good today, he gets to go home. So they need prayer.
Thank you. Anyone else? Oh, sorry.
My brother-in-law, who's experiencing chronic back pain, and they haven't been able to find out why.
Okay. Anyone else? Okay. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you with much on our minds this morning, Lord, lifting up grandchildren, lifting up healing that you've brought to Dean Lenhart. We're bringing up others who have back pain and have arthritic pain, and we ask for your healing, your comfort for all of these. We lift up Bob Flowers, Nina Rhodes, and we ask you to continue to be with Don Dahl family as they grieve his passing. And we lift up Scott Barrett as he brings the message to us today. May we hear your word in it. And now we'll recite the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us our bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Would the ushers come forward, please? Dear Heavenly Father, please accept these gifts that we brought to you this morning. We pray that they may go to further your kingdom here on earth. We thank you, Lord, for all that you've given us. We ask this in your precious holy name, Lord. Amen. You may be seated. And now we will turn to hymn number 497, I'll Live for Him. Scott Barrett has blessed us with his presence this morning in delivering our message, and his scripture readings are included in his message, so they're not listed separately as they usually are for Vincent. So please join me in welcoming Scott Barrett.
You better wait till the end and see whether you want to do that at the end of the message. But I want you all to know how blessed I am to be here today, how blessed I am to live in this great state of Ohio and in Hardin County. You know, I've traveled all over America. I've traveled over much of Europe, and I want to live no place except here in Hardin County. And I don't know whether you know it, folks, about the, in a rural community like this, but Ohio is the eighth largest pork-producing state in the United States. Ohio is. And Hardin County is the seventh largest pork-producing county in the state of Ohio out of 88 counties. So I thought when I heard this, this would be a good way to start. I heard of a gentleman that was driving along the road, and in front of him was a truck, and in the back of the truck there was a bed of pigs being hauled someplace. And the truck went over a large bump, and believe it or not, one of the pigs flew out of the back of the bed. And the man saw it, and he tooted the horn, but the truck didn't stop, so he jumped out of the car, and he picked the pig up and put the pig in the front seat with him, and then took off like a bat out of wherever bats come out of to try to catch this truck to give them back their pig. And he hadn't been able to catch him, and he sees a red light, and a deputy pulls him over and says, "Sir, do you realize how fast you were going?" And he explained. He said, "Well, there was a truck in front of me. You can't see him now, but this pig flew out of the back, and I was trying to catch him to give him the pig." And the deputy said, "Well, I'll tell you what you need to do." He said, "He's too far gone." He said, "You need to take the pig to the zoo." The man said, "Well, all right, he would do that." And so the deputy left, and the guy got in his car and drove. Well, the next day, the deputy's tooling along the road, and he sees this same car, and he notices that there's a pig in the front seat with this guy. So he stops the guy again, and he said, "I thought I told you to take that pig to the zoo." And the gentleman said, "I did, and he enjoyed it so much, today we're going to the beach." Now, It's very risky for me to tell a joke because I had a feeling maybe you'd all just sit and stare at me. I tried it on a couple of attorneys that were in my office last week and they just laughed raucously. And I said, you're just trying to suck up to me. It's not that funny of a story. But anyhow, because I've enjoyed so much being here in the past, I'm glad to be here today. This is like going to the beach for me. So time is moving on. I've been speaking here on occasion for a number of years. Of course, I think I started when Douglas was your pastor, Douglas being, of course, my cousin. But, you know, the time is moving on for all of us. And I had to laugh. When I was ready, you know, I was term limited out of my office as judge. The Constitution doesn't let us start a new term after we're at the great advanced age that I am. Well, just a couple weeks, well, actually, just a couple days before I left office, the Kenton Times carried an article on me with my front page picture, and it said, "Time catches up with Barrett." And I read that and I thought, golly, it sounds like they think I'm going to die or something like that soon. I thought of Mark Twain, who said that reports of my death are greatly exaggerated. Well, I wasn't ready to do that, but the Apostle Paul talks about the importance of him and I think us having fruitful work to do. And even though my time is running out and catching up with me, I still look for fruitful work. And I can't think of anything I consider more fruitful than being here to talk with you good folks about the word of the Lord and the Savior we have. So let's just take a moment to pray. Dear Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Ladies and gentlemen, it's often said that a good sermon consists of 3 points, and I thought a joke. So I was talking to Pastor Douglas this week. He said, I think of it as 3 points and a poem. Well, I've never heard the 3 points in a poem. And to be honest, when I would be here with Doug, I don't think I ever heard Doug give poems either. But he said, so anyhow, today you're getting 3 points and a joke and a poem, so that I don't miss anything. But and what am I going to actually do, ladies and gentlemen? I'm going to announce the 3 points so that hopefully you'll be able to zero in on the 3 points. I was in a church not too long ago, and I thought, I'd love to go outside and ask the people what the sermon was about, because I have a feeling somehow it kind of goes in one side and comes out the other and doesn't linger too long. So I'm hoping to make this linger just a tiny bit by giving you the 3 points. The first point in this message today, ladies and gentlemen, is we are living in unusually stressful times. Charles Dickens began his novel, The Tale of Two Cities, with the line, "It was the best of times, it was the worst of times." And I think that's true today, but there's perhaps something just a little special about the stress level in the days in which we live. A couple months ago, I started reading the book for my next book club. We choose, the person having the next session gets to choose the book. So somebody chose this book called The Measure. And the plot of the book is that one morning, everybody in the entire world wakes up, and outside their door is a little wooden box. And in that little wooden box is a string. It turns out that they finally figure out what this is about is the length of the string tells them how long they have to live. And the whole world seems to go into a state of confusion and frenzy because it seemed like so many people didn't realize or were not willing to acknowledge that they were going to die. They seemed upset about the reality facing them in the face that they were going to die. And then the separate reality, can you imagine if you got a long string and your neighbor got a short string? There was all this problem. The short stringers, they called, were worried because they were going to die so much more quickly than the long stringers. The whole book irritates me. I think probably because I want to view everything in the world, from a Christian perspective. And my death is a reality, whether it happens today or 30 years from now. I remember a number of years ago when our grand chapter, the Order of the Eastern Star, celebrated its 100th anniversary. There was a big ball in Columbus. And so many of us were at this large ball, and the women were all in long gowns, and the men were in tuxedos. And one of my mother's best friends was there, a woman she'd been an officer with. This was on Saturday night. And on Sunday, this friend was a church organist, and she went to church and played the organ, and as she pulled out on the road, she was hit by a car and was killed. And I remember thinking, we were just dancing together last night. Life is so tenuous. All of us need to understand that it faces us as a present reality today, and if not today, maybe 30 years from now. So ladies and gentlemen, I would not recommend this book. To be honest, I haven't finished it. I got so far. I will finish it. We don't meet for a while yet. But shortly after I started reading this book, I saw in the news there was a study that had come out. The study was from a mental health clinic in Florida that studied the 50 states in the union to try to determine the stress level of the citizens of that state. They asked them the same questions. Are you stressed about your society, your government? Are you stressed about this, that? So then they came out, and there was a list in the article. There was a list of the top 10 states where people felt most stressed. And if you can believe it, Ohio was in the top 10 most stressful states. Find that very hard to believe, ladies and gentlemen. It didn't contain the states that had rampant crime, didn't contain the states that had absurdly high tax rates. Do you realize in Ohio, our highest income tax level in Ohio is 3.8%. In California, the top income tax level is 14.4%. But California didn't hit this list of stressful states, nor did New York, which has a top tax level of 10.9 and rampant crime. I was just there a few weeks ago. Another state that was in the top 10 was the state of Arkansas, which most of us would consider kind of a laid-back southern state. My cousins live in Arkansas, and I sent it to Helen, and she sent back and said there must be some political agenda to this. That makes no sense whatsoever. But be that as it may, independently, and I did look at other studies, there are quite a few studies about this, Ohio was not in the top 10 of the other studies. But the point is that there is a determination made that these are stressful times. And the question would be, we as sisters and brothers, we as believers in Christ, how should we be responding to the level of stress? No matter what level of stress, whether you think your life is pretty placid right now or you're at a great level of stress, we are all called by Scripture to handle that stress with the blessed assurance that Jesus is ours. The Scriptures tell us to cast our cares on the Lord. Jesus said, "Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Toward the end, Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me." And another place the Scripture says, "Be anxious about nothing." So when I saw that Ohio was in the top 10 most stressful states, I realized right about that time, Ohio, the state of Ohio, started an ad campaign. And I don't know whether you've seen it on the news, but the ad campaign is from the Mental Health Department of Ohio, trying to talk to people about how to handle stress. So the state of Ohio is taking stress carefully, and in it they talk, there is a number you can call, and this is maybe not a Christian thing, there is a number if you or somebody you love seems extremely stressed out or is suicidal, there's a number you can call, 988, where there are trained counselors ready to help you. I decided to call that number this past week just to see how it was. I was a little worried that I'd call that number and then there would be a knock on the door and they would be doing a wellness check on my house. So I explained to the gentleman first of all, I dialed the wrong number and got the message that this number is not dialed. And I thought, well, this is kind of stressful. I had the wrong number. So anyhow, but I got a gentleman. First of all, this is interesting. First of all, they spoke to me in Spanish, which challenges me a little. Then they said, if you are a veteran, dial something. Then the second thing they said, if you are a member of the LGBT community, dial this. And then finally they said, otherwise hold on the line. And so I held on the line, and a gentleman came on. I explained to him, I said, I'm a judge, I'm getting ready for a sermon. I said, I'm just interested how you're doing this. It was very positive. It was very helpful. It was actually out of Lima, Ohio. They divide the states into districts. So I encourage you, if you or somebody you know or love is dealing with issues not as well as they could, this is a resource for you. And so 988 is the number you can call. The point being for my message is, number one, these are perhaps unusually stressful times. Number two, be prepared. Did you notice the name of my sermon is Ho, 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 H-O-E, 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 not ho-ho-ho like Santa Claus. And I promise you I'm not referring to a lady of ill repute by using the term ho. The title of my message is something that I've remembered so much of my adult life. It comes from what is probably a mythological story about a man called Francis, someday to be known as Saint Francis of Assisi. And the story goes as follows. Saint Francis was out hoeing his garden, and a passerby asked him, "Francis, if you were told that you were going to die at sunset, what would you do?" And Francis responded, "I would finish hoeing my garden." If you were told that you were going to die at sunset, what would you do? Francis said, "I would finish hoeing my garden." Francis replied with complete calmness, with complete trust in the day and the eternity ahead. It appeared from the story, or at least my interpretation is always, that Francis was prepared for whatever life had to hold for him. What would I do if I knew that when I pulled out of this parking lot on my way home, I was going to be hit by a car and this was my last opportunity? What would you do if you knew that same thing? Let's turn to the scripture. Interesting scripture. Jesus, we're talking about the moments before he died, the day before he died. Jesus is talking to his apostles, and he gives them this story that he says, "The kingdom of heaven is like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, and 5 of them were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps, but did not take enough oil for them for the night. The wise ones, however, took jars of oil with them for their lamps. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, and all of the virgins became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, the cry rang out, 'The bridegroom is coming. Come out and meet him.' Then all the virgins woke up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish ones said to the wise, 'Give us some of your oil. Our lamps are about to run out.' And the wise ones said, 'No,' they replied. 'There may not be enough for both us and you. Instead, you go into the town and buy oil from the sellers for yourselves.' But while they were on their way to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins who were already ready went with him into the banquet feast, and the door was shut. Later, the foolish ones came and said, 'Sir, sir, we're here. Open the door to us.' But he replied, 'I tell you the truth, I don't know you.' And Jesus said, 'Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the time.'" As I said, this is one of the last teachings Jesus gave before the Last Supper and then the crucifixion. How interesting, during those last moments of teaching, that he concentrated on watch and be prepared. I truly think this scripture is more about being prepared than watching, because you notice all 10 of the virgins fell asleep. None of them were awake to watch for the bridegroom. They all fell asleep, but 5 of them were prepared for the delay and for the coming of the bridegroom, and 5 of them were not prepared. So the question today for each of us is, are we prepared for what lay ahead? What does it mean to be prepared? So many things in the world today shout for our attention. And of course, I'll bet everybody here knows this is a presidential election year, and they're shouting for attention almost nonstop. The economy, inflation, living on a fixed income, an out-of-control border, the world situation, China, climate change, transgender rights. Who among us 20 years ago would have seen that one coming? And it's a significant thought during this campaign. And on a personal basis, those are all world things. On a personal basis, each of us has to cope with our health, with our job, with our family. After worrying about all of those things, how much time do we have left for Jesus? Paul tells us that each of us is to have the mind of Christ. Too many of us only have a worldly mind and only think religious stuff when we're called upon to do so, like here or perhaps at a funeral. But we should not be satisfied with only a worldly mind. Our goal must be to have as our first resource and our primary thought process to have the mind of Christ. Ruth Davis was my piano teacher, a woman who had so much influence on my life in many ways. And I remember her telling me that when she was in her 20s, after college, she moved to Italy and taught in a girls' finishing school. Naturally, she needed to learn to speak Italian there, and she studied the language. And I can remember, just like it was yesterday, her telling me she remembered the moment, the day, when she started thinking in Italian rather than thinking in English and then translating it into Italian. I remember her saying she remembers the day when she would look at this and think of the word piatto rather than think plate, piatto. She started thinking in Italian. And I've never forgotten that, because one of the goals of my entire life has been to be in the position that I think of the things of Christ rather than thinking world. How many of us think worldly, think, boy, I'd like to say this. No, I shouldn't do that. How nice it would be not to start with, boy, I'd like to say this nasty thing, to simply start with the mind of Christ. So my goal is to not think in a worldly mind, but rather to think with the mind of Christ. What does that mean? It'd be interesting if we had time, and we don't have time, to take a few minutes and just say, what do you think that means, to think with the mind of Christ? Well, Jesus said, one of the most difficult things that most of us want to ignore, Jesus said, be perfect, just as my heavenly Father is perfect. Most of us would say, I'm going to ignore that because I can't do that. And yet that is what we are called to do. Do many of you know, how many of you have ever been to an ordination ceremony for a United Methodist pastor? None of you. Well, Roberta has, and of course I've been to many of them. There's a series of historical questions that are always, John Wesley's questions, that are always asked of the ordinands. They're on stage. I'm quite sure the global church will do the same thing. I feel sure they're going to use the same historical questions. One of the questions they ask all of the people being ordained is, are you moving on to perfection? And they're all supposed to answer yes. I have a feeling a lot of them probably are challenged with that. The next question, though, interestingly enough, is, the first question is, are you moving on to perfection? The next question is, do you expect to be made perfect in love in this life? And they're expected to answer that. I talked to Cousin Doug about that. That one's a little easier. Both of them are difficult because many of us don't think we can reach a level of perfection about anything. But to be perfect, to me, is to be like Jesus. And how can we do this? All right, point three. Point one, extremely stressful times. Point two, we need to be prepared. Point three, how do we gain the mind of Christ? How can we be prepared like St. Francis was to simply continue hoeing his garden? This topic could provide a whole series of messages, but basically I think Scripture tells us that we are predestined to be conformed to the image of Christ. But I don't think that's an immediate process for each of us. It's a lifetime process, a gradual process where we must work intentionally to overcome the detriment of the fall caused by Adam in the Garden of Eden. In the first epistle of John, he says, "Beloved, we are already God's children, but he has not yet shown us what we will be like when he appears, but we know that we will be like him, for we shall see him as he is." One day, each of us who follow Christ will be with Jesus, and we will be like Jesus. But until that day, we are called upon to continually strive to conform ourselves to his image day by day. I so yearn to think like the Apostle Paul, who writes to the church at Philippi. I love these words, and this is a huge part of who I am as a believer. Paul says, "For me to live is Christ, and to die gain. If I go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far, but it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. I think those are beautiful words. It's not so much that Paul is tired of life. He rejoices in the fruitful work that he thinks lays before him. But better than anything, he wants to go to be in the presence of Jesus. He wants to depart and be with Christ. I think that's why the book I mentioned is so irritating to me. Nobody seems to see death as a gain. My mantra is, and I say this so often to people, the worst day I have has a benefit because with the passage of one day, I'm one day closer to being in the presence of Jesus. So every day is worth something because it moves me one step further to being in the presence of Jesus. So, ladies and gentlemen, as I said, Doug thought we should have a poem. So I'm going to tell you, you know, one of my favorite anthems in the last years when I was director of music at First Church inside town was an anthem by the name of A Little More Like You. We sang it a number of times, and then we sang it on my last Sunday at First Church when I was culminating 45 years of being director of music at First Church. So I'm going to give you the words of this because I love these words. I had these words printed. These words hung in my bathroom at the courthouse. I had them beside the mirror on the bathroom because these are words that every day I can think of. They start, grant me more holiness. Make me devoted deep within. I plead for patience in my trials and more sorrow for my sin. A deeper faith in you, dear Lord, please give me every day. Let me find joy in my journey and more purpose when I pray. And then the chorus is, this is my prayer, O Lord, when this day is through. Was I a little less like me and a little more like you? My lone desire in all I say or do, was I a little less like me and a little more like you? I think that's what gaining the mind of Christ is, that we want to grow into the image of Christ day by day. So if you'll allow, let's have a time of prayer. There is a second verse. I'm going to paraphrase the second verse as my closing prayer. So if you will, please pray with me. Dear Lord, please give each of us more gratitude. Help us to love you even more and take pride only in your glory and trust only in your word. Let us shed sorrow's tears when others pain, when others grieve. And may my neighbor please see Jesus every time that he sees me. This is our prayer, O Lord. When this day is through, were we a little less like ourselves and a little more like you? May our lone desire in all we say or do be that each day we are a little less like me and a little more like you. Thank you, Lord, for this time with these good people. Lord, please bless us as we go forth from this place. In the name of Jesus, we all pray. Amen. And now, if you will stand, we're going to sing one of the great hymns of the church, number 596, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms.
did make some copies of that last, the words to that last anthem. If any of you are interested, I have a few of the copies. I imagine Hannah can make more, should you want it. 988 is the number to call if anybody you know or love is not dealing with life well. And another thing you can do is just try to lead them into the presence of the Lord and know that they can lean on the everlasting arms. So let's receive God's blessings. And now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before his throne of grace, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and power, dominion, both now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you, everybody.